you think you know, but let me tell it.
Life and favor upon me.
God, thank you for your mercy.
God of mercy.
And you love me. Life and favor.
Life and favor upon me.
Oh, how wondrous. God is my story.
Life and favor upon me.
You wouldn't believe my real testimony. Can't imagine. Some people, they walked out on me and they gave up on me, said I wouldn't make it, but God brought me out.
All the things I've gone.
If you only knew, you'd understand why I praise like this. Come on, can we take it up?
Friendship. David wrote in Psalms 103 and 1, he says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name." Did you come out that you would praise and bless the name of Jesus this morning? Amen. Amen. This is first Sunday in July. Lord have mercy. Time is just racing. It's just moving right along. But we're here to praise and lift up the name of Jesus. Are you here to praise him with us? Amen. Amen. First Sunday, that of our ordinances of communion and water baptism that will be taking place at 10:30, we're going to ask that you would stand as the officers come and they will prepare the table for the Lord's Supper. You may be seated in the house of the Lord. We now turn this portion of our service over to our deacons who will be leading us in the devotional hour. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Good morning. Good morning. Again, good morning.
Good morning.
It's a blessing to be in the house of the Lord this morning, isn't it? God's been so gracious to us. Yeah, we're day, every first Sunday, to thank him for his body and blood that was shed on the cross for us. For a debt he didn't know, for a debt we could not pay. We were being bought with a price. But because of that, we owe him everything. God bless you. I'm part of your devotional team this morning. My name is Deacon Sistrunk. We have Deacon Ingram, who's going to be doing the hymn. And we have Deacon Diggs, who will be doing the prayer. Amen. Our scripture this morning is coming out of John, the 15th chapter, verses 1 through 13. It reads us thus. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purges it, they may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. And the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except abide in the vine. No more can ye, except ye abide in me. I am the vine, and ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, ye can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he cast forth as a branch, and is withered, and a man gather them, and cast them into a fire, and they are burned. If ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. Here is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples. As the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. If ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things which I have spoken unto you, that my joy may remain in you, and that your joy might be full. This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Verse 13, greater love hath no man than this, that a man that lay down his life for his friends. Just think, Jesus laid down his life for us. Such a blessing for us. Such a blessing. So we should do everything to make sure that we give God our first. Amen? Amen. God bless you.
Guide me, oh, that great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. Guide me, Jehovah. Thank you.
Amen. Let us bow our heads as we go to the Lord in prayer. Put aside everything that you're doing now and concentrate as we go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, which art in heaven, we come at this moment in time, Lord, thanking you for another day. A day that you've blessed us with, Lord. A day that was not promised to us, Lord. So for this first Sunday in the month of July, Lord, we give thanks, Lord. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for the precious blood of your son, Jesus Christ, Lord, who died on the cross for us, that we may have a right to this day, Lord. Father God, we ask express your prayer for our brothers and sisters that are on their way. Give them safe travel to the congregation, Lord, that they may be able to worship you in spirit and in truth, Lord. And Father God, for our sisters and brothers that are locked in this morning, Lord, some due to sickness, Lord, some maybe because of incarceration, Lord, and some who the devil touched and just kept them from coming out this morning, Lord, touch them right now in their spirit, Lord, that they may look to you, to look to the hills from which cometh their help, Lord. Father God, we just thank you for everything you've done for us in our life, Lord. Help us through these difficult times, Lord. And Father God, there may be one here this morning, Lord, who don't know you in the pardon of their sins, Lord. We just ask that they may come running, asking, what must I do to be saved? Somewhere along this service, Lord. Father God, we express your prayer for the man that's going to step in John's shoes this morning, Lord. He that's going to preach your word, Lord. Crown his head with knowledge, Lord. Touch his tongue that he may decrease, that your word may increase, Lord. So that this body of friendship family may be touched. That the spirit may move freely throughout, Lord. And that we can come away saying, thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord. These and all the blessings we ask in your son, Jesus' name. And for thy sake we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you for participation in our devotional service. Now we'll turn hands of our choir. Amen. God bless you.
Can we all just stand up this morning and give God some praise? He's so worthy. He's so worthy. Y'all can do better than that. He is so worthy of all the praise, all the glory and honor. Boy, if I had 10,000 tongues, I couldn't praise him enough. He's so worthy. Why y'all stop clapping? He is so worthy. He is so worthy. He allowed us to see another day. Did y'all do it on your own? No, you didn't. But God, he is so worthy. We ask you to join in this morning with us in our praise and worship. And I wanted to say to our own minister of music that we are praying for you.
Yes.
We love you, and we know God's got you.
heart. Listen to this.
God, my Savior. God, my healer. God, my deliverer. Yes, He is. Yes, He is.
Everybody sing.
To be with the youth choir singing, just to bring you a song called Amazing. So amazing.
So amazing.
So amazing.
So amazing.
So amazing.
So amazing.
So amazing.
So amazing.
So amazing.
So amazing.
You call the sun. The sun and moon to shine, and I'm so glad you're mine. Oh, I'm glad to say you're mine.
And all of you,
see, you're amazed. is good. God is good. Jesus is amazing. You should have a testimony on your lips. He brought you here this morning. Thank you for participating in our praise and worship.
Amen.
Amen. Let's give God a hand clap of praise. Keep your hands together. He's so worthy. Don't you just want to clap him all the time when you think about Jesus? How many of you know we serve a mighty good God? How many of you know we serve a mighty good God?
Praise
the Lord,
everybody. He's
a
mighty good God.
He's a
mighty good God.
Oh, bless his name.
Praise
the Lord.
friendship. I want you to help us lift God up this morning.
Hallelujah. Salvation and glory. Honor and power unto the Lord our God. For the Lord our God is mighty. Yes, the Lord our God is omnipotent. The Lord our God, He is wonderful. Sing along with me.
Hallelujah. Lift them up this morning. This morning.
Yes, the Lord our God is omnipotent. The Lord our God, He is wonderful.
Hallelujah. Salvation and glory.
Back on Calvary,
it's such a special way.
To the Lord.
good morning, friendship. Giving all praise, honor, and glory to our Lord Jesus Christ, to Pastor Trotter and other ministers on the roster, to our First Lady, Sister Trotter, to our deacons and our deaconesses, and to all the members of the Friendship Baptist Church. My name is Vince Darius, and I'm here to welcome our guests. If you are not currently a member of the Friendship Baptist Church, please stand and remain standing, please. On behalf of Pastor Trotter and the Hospitality Committee, I welcome you to Friendship. We recognize this morning you definitely had a choice as to what church you would worship with, and we truly feel honored and blessed that you chose Friendship. If there's anything at all we can do to make your stay with us more enjoyable and spirit-filled, please don't hesitate to ask. Friendship family, please stand and acknowledge our guests.
Friendship. It is indeed a blessing to be in the house of the Lord one more time. Amen. We've experienced His grace and His mercy. Amen. That He has kept us since we've last gathered together. Amen. Only God can do that. Amen. Keep all of us safe from all hurt, harm, and danger, and then to bring us back together in worship another time. Amen. Some of you ought to be like me. You ought to be praising God. He has kept you over the holidays while you were traveling. Amen. Up and down the dangerous highway. Amen. Brought us back safely. Amen. Even if all you had to do was come from a street in the colony over here. Amen. We ought to give Him glory and praise because things can happen. Amen. Close to home. I want to say to those of you who are visiting with us today, welcome to Friendship. We are glad to have you. Amen. Amen. Out of all of the churches that you could have gone to today, you came to share with us, and we thank God for your being here. Please come back and share with us again. Amen. We also welcome those who are viewing us by live streaming. Amen. Over the internet, we welcome you to Friendship into this worship service as well. Amen. Did you enjoy our men on last Sunday? Amen. I guess y'all did your patty caking. Amen. Now, did you enjoy the men on last Sunday? Amen. 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 They did an awesome job. Amen. You say, how do you know, Pastor? I was watching. Amen. That's how I know they did an awesome job on last Sunday. And we thank God for our men. Amen. And for leading us through those songs last Sunday. Spirit filled. Amen. They sang so well, I was reminded that Friendship still has a choir. And it's not time to replace them with the men yet. Amen. So, brother, that's how well you did. Amen. Got people already reminding me, amen, that we still have a choir. Amen. All right. Please be in prayer for Brother Kevin Davis. Amen. If you didn't know, he was involved in a motorcycle accident on this past Sunday. He's at home recuperating. Amen. So please be in prayer for him. Amen. Amen. Sister India had surgery on this past Tuesday. Please keep her in your prayer. This is the daughter of Sister Burns. Amen. Those of you who are volunteers for the Vacation Bible School, amen, the Vacation Bible School will be taking place July 21st through July 25th. If you are a volunteer, there is a mandatory meeting this coming Saturday, July 12th at 10 a.m. in Solomon's Porch. So all volunteers for Vacation Bible School, please make yourselves available for this meeting on this coming Saturday at 10 a.m. This comes from our directors for Vacation Bible School, Deacon and Sister Wallace. Amen. Please be in prayer for our choir. Amen. They're on their annual trip. Amen. For the year, promoting their CD. Amen. And they will be back in town this week. But please be in prayer for them while they are away. Amen. Others who are away still on vacation and for the holidays, please keep the whole and entire membership in prayer. We invite you to come out to our midweek services, all of our ministry meetings throughout the week. Amen. Just because it's summer and we are on vacation, amen, the church has not closed. Amen. So we're still having our weekly meetings and we're still having, amen, our midweek services on Wednesday evening. Our Bible studies Wednesday morning and Wednesday evening. So please avail yourself, amen, to these events that are going on here at Friendship. Also, we will be in, amen, the African-American Conference this week over in Fort Worth. Amen. This is part of the BGCT, the Baptist General Convention of Texas, and we will be there Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. So please be in prayer, amen, as some of the members of our church will participate in the African-American Conference that will take place in Fort Worth. Amen. So good to see all of you. It's good to be home. Amen. It's good to get away. Amen. But it's always best to come back home. Amen. I missed you on last Sunday. I hope you missed me. Amen. If you didn't, I'm back. Amen. I'm back anyway. Amen. But I know you missed me. Amen. Amen. All right. God bless you. Our deacons are coming at this time to receive our tithes, offering, and our contributions to the building fund. Amen.
Good morning, Friendship. Please bow your heads in a word of prayer before we receive our offering. Our Father and our Father, Father, it's again and once again, we just come before your throne of grace. Father, first of all, we come thanking you, Father, for another privilege just to come before your holy and righteous name. Father, we ask that you bless this offering that we're about to receive. Bless those that gave a special blessing. For those that wanted to give, but for some reason they have not. Father, we will make sure that we use this offering for one thing only. That is to uplift your kingdom on this side. Father, we thank you for what you've done and thank you for what you're about to do. Father, these and all of the blessings we ask in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.
Seems way too hard, but ain't nothing too hard for God. Say I need just a little more. Jesus.
Hey, I need just a little more
Jesus.
Stand. James chapter 1, just a couple of verses. And we'll read verses 2, 3, and 4. And it reads, my brethren, count it all joy when ye fall into divers temptation, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. But let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. May the Lord bless the reader, the hearers, and the doers of his word. Father in heaven, we thank you again for this opportunity, for this privilege that you've given to us, and that you've allowed us to be in your house of worship one more time. Now we just ask that you would have your way in this preaching hour. We humbly submit ourselves before you, and we just pray that you would use us for your glory, that in this time that glory will be brought to your name. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. My brethren, verse 2 says, count it all joy when ye fall into divers temptations. For a thought for just a little while this morning, we are going to talk about, remember, your troubles are only a test. Remember, your troubles are only a test. Amen. At least once a month, on our televisions, radios, we have what they call a test of the emergency broadcasting system. For about a minute, we hear those funny noises and funny sounds. And at the end, a voice would say, this was only a test. The voice would go on to say, at the end of the test, that if this was an actual emergency, you would have been told where to tune in for further information. Now, the world, every once in a while, tests their emergency system to make sure that it's working so that we don't get caught in some grave emergency without any warning. But as Christians, how do we really know that the faith we really have, if it really works, if it's never tested? Now we say we have faith. We say we really trust God. But how do we know that we really have that faith, and how do we know we really have that test if our faith is never tested. Now, James is a book about practical living. James is the half-brother of Jesus. And he teaches us that Christianity must not only be believed, but it must be lived. It has been said by some theologians that the book of James contradicts the writings of Paul, but there is no contradiction. You see, James tells us that it's not enough to talk about being a Christian, but we must also live the Christian life. You see, Paul in his writing talks about the root of justification, while James talks about the fruit of justification. In other words, Paul tells us that we are justified in Christ. And James says, since we are justified in Christ, then as Christians, we ought to live like it. John Calvin once said, faith alone saves. But the faith that saves is not alone. Now, every time we turn on the TV, or tune in the radio, or pick up a newspaper or magazine, we are bombarded with advertisements of products promising to make us look better, feel better, walk better, feel confident with our smile. There are even those products that promise to help us to remember better. But most of us would never spend our hard-earned money on those 1995 products that say buy one and get one absolutely free. Amen. But if there are some who think they need these products, God bless you. Amen. But what James talked about in our text today is not about what we might go through. Hear what I'm saying? It's not about what we might go through, but James talks about what we will go through. You see, no matter whether you are rich, whether you are poor, whether you are saved, unsaved, tall or short, if you live long enough, guess what? You will face some trouble in your life. Now, James gives us the prescription for relief when trouble shows up. He says, counting it all joy will bring relief when trouble shows up. You see, it's realizing that our troubles, they are only a test. And when we realize that they are only a test, they allows us to count what we are going through as joy. You see, James in our text tells us three things about troubles. First of all, they are often sudden. James says, when ye fall, which denotes sudden. Amen. It might take you a long time to hit the ground. Amen. But falling comes suddenly. You see, trouble does not always warn us that it's on the way. Amen. It does not always knock on the door or ring the doorbell. Most of the time, it just shows up. It's just like walking along a pathway, carefree and full of joy, when all of a sudden you trip, and then you begin stumbling, and before you know it, you're on the ground. The fall was sudden and unexpected, and that's the way trouble shows up most of the time. So first of all, he tells us they're often sudden. And then secondly, he tells us, amen, about our troubles, is that our troubles, they are certain. Amen. He did not say, if ye fall. That's not what he said. He said, but when ye fall. When means it's going to happen. Amen. Get ready for it, because it will happen. You see, there are a lot of Christians who feel like if they don't walk too close to God, then they won't have any or at least many trouble. But it's the close walk with God that really helps us when we find ourselves dealing with life's ups and downs. You see, with trouble, it's not if, but when. Now, the third thing James tells us about troubles is that they are sorted. He uses the word divers temptation. In other words, James is saying that troubles come in different ways, different forms, and different sizes. You see, one person may face this, while another faces that. And then another faces this and that. But again, however the trouble comes, James tells us the same thing. He said, count it all joy. Now, I know that it's hard to count it all joy when you're facing life difficult. But another key is to remember that to every trouble, there is a purpose. You see, God never allows us to go through. Notice what I said. Let me say it again. Somebody missed that. God never allows us to go through. Anybody listening to me? God never allows us to go through anything in life without a purpose. Amen. That's the reason why I'm glad that the scripture said, and it came to pass. Amen. Amen. When trouble shows up at our door, it tries or it tests our faith. In verse 3 of our text, James said, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. This shows purpose. So whatever you're going through right now in your life, it's not just happening for no reason. God has a purpose for you being where you are. God has a purpose for you being in the situation that you are in. Know that there is a purpose in everything that happens in your life. So often all we see is the troubles that we are going through. We never take the time to realize that God has a purpose for us going through what we go through. You see, when we focus on the realization of a purpose rather than the trouble, we realize that we'll come out of our trials and tribulations better than when we went in. We will not only come out better, but we'll come out stronger. A songwriter said we'll even come out wiser. Amen, than when we first went in. Nobody goes to the hospital and go through surgery expecting to come out feeling the same. Amen. But when we go through surgery, we are looking for better results. You see, after the surgery, we might hurt for just a little while. Anybody listening to me? But as time goes on, amen, we begin to see the real joy, amen, of having gone through the surgery to correct whatever the situation is. Amen. That's the way it is when we go through our trials and our tribulation. You see, we need to understand something about the enemy. Do you not know he loves to see Christians suffer? Let me tell you the reason why he loves to see us suffer. Because he sees an opportunity for defeat. Can I get a witness? Amen. He likes to see us suffering because he sees an opportunity to try and bring us down. Amen. To try and knock us off of the path that God has placed us on. But when we're going through our trials and tribulations, if we can only remember that there is a purpose in what we are going through. How many of you are born again? You are children of the Most High God. How many of you are saved? Then if you're born again, whatever you are going through right now, amen, God has a purpose for you going through what you're going through. Amen. Don't worry about what folks say. Don't worry about what folks think. Yes, no. That there's a purpose, a God-given purpose for you going through what you're going through. You remember Job? There was a purpose for Job going through all that he went through. There was at least three things that God desired to bring out of Job's suffering. First of all, God was proving a point to Satan. Secondly, God was proving a point to Job's three self-righteous friends. And then thirdly, God was proving a point to Job. Now, Satan, first of all, needed to know that there are those who are willing to continue to serve God and be faithful in spite of the troubles they face. You see, Satan, you remember the story? Amen. I was going to read my sermon, but I'm going to preach it this morning. Amen. Amen. You remember the story? Amen. Of how Satan, amen, came to God and he said, God asked him, why are you? What are you doing here? And Satan said, I've been going to and fro. And I done messed up everybody down there on earth. And I don't have nothing else to do. And the Lord said, have you considered my servant Job? Amen. And sometimes when we are going through things, it's because God has said, have you considered my servant, whatever your name might be. Amen. And Satan said, I considered him, but you've got a hedge of protection around him. And there's so much in this, but I can't tell it all. But what it tells me is that Satan can't get to me. Satan can't get to you unless God removes. And if God removes the hedge, then let me tell you what that means. It means you can handle whatever it is you are going through. So you have to prove a point to Satan. Because Satan said the only reason that Job is serving you is because of all the stuff. Anybody listening to me? All the stuff that you've given him. And notice what he said. If you let me at Job's stuff. Do you know the reason why he said that? Because he had messed up so many other folk by taking their stuff that he thought that's what all Christians were about. He thought that we're all about stuff. Now, if your stuff was gone, if your stuff was all of a sudden gone, would I see you this morning? Amen, amen. Job lost everything that he had. And that's what he said. He lost his donkeys. That was his car. All of his. Y'all not listening to me. Lost his camels. All of his cattle, that was his job. And then he lost all of his children. That was his family. If you lost your job, your nice car that you shined up yesterday, getting it ready for church today. All right. And then you lost your family. Would you be able to sit down like Job and say, the Lord give it and the Lord take it away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Well, let me hurry up. Let me hurry up. So he had to prove to Satan that there is somebody that serves me because they love me. How many of you love the Lord? And if you love him and you didn't have any stuff, would you still love him? Now, it's one thing to lose your stuff. It's one thing to lose your job. It's another thing to lose your family. And Job said, naked I came into this world. And he said, naked I'm going to leave. The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Satan went back again. And the Lord had to prove something else to Satan. He said to the Lord, he said, I'm just coming to and fro. He said, I've already turned you loose on Job, and you said he was going to curse me to my face. But Job still maintains his integrity. I'm talking about God had to prove something to Satan. And sometimes God uses us and what we are going through to tell the devil. Because, you see, the devil is saying, ain't nobody serving God. All those folk at Friendship, they're just going over there, sitting down, singing, getting up and going home. They are not paying you no attention. Every now and then, God has to pick somebody out and show Satan that I've still got somebody in Friendship, that no matter what they're going through, they still love me. So Satan said, I tell you what. And you know, we love looking pretty. We love looking handsome. And that's the reason why some folk come to church late. So did everybody. Y'all want me to get back to my paper? Because I'll keep it real if I don't get back to the paper. Amen. And they wait until so that everybody can see them when they walk in. And the usher will stop about three rows from the back and point, and they'll walk right by the usher and come. But let me tell you what happened. He said, you let me touch his body. I've got his stuff. I've got his family. I got his job. Now, if you let me just do one more thing, I know this will be it. So he said, let me touch his body. The Lord said, you can touch his body, but you can't have his life. I'm talking about looking good. The Bible says that Job was covered with sores from the crown of his head all the way to the sole of his feet. And Job was sitting there, and his wife looked at him. The only thing he had left. Y'all will get that in a minute. The only thing he had left. And she looked at him. And she said, Joe, you are a mess. I hope that if I ever start looking a mess, that Sister Trotter will still stay with me. Amen. She forgot the vows for better or for worse. Amen. It's because she thought, I've lost my children. Job, we are broke. You don't have no job. You sick and you can't go to work. And she said, you ought to just curse God and die. And Job looked at her and said, you sound like a foolish woman. And what he was saying was, you don't sound like the woman that I married. Amen, amen. So God had to prove something to Satan. Let me tell you the second thing God had to prove. He had to prove to Job's three friends that trouble is not always a sign of sin. Amen. Because when Job's three friends came to visit him, they heard about him. They had to come see for themselves. And when they got there, the Bible said they sit there and looked at Job for 7 days and never said a word. What kind of friends are that? Amen. That will come to visit you when you are sick. When you're going through and just sit there for 7 days and not say a word. And finally, when they opened their mouths and started talking, they said, Job, the only way that something like this could have happened is you must have committed a sin somewhere. And Job maintained his integrity through all that those friends brought against him. And sometimes as Christians, when you're going through something, we always have these so-called holy rollers that will come to your bedside. And they'll say, I have a word from the Lord. He told me to tell you. That if you confess your sin, that he'll raise you up. And if it was me, I'd be looking at them saying, if you would confess your sin, then you wouldn't come into my room talking about the Lord said when I'm laying here and he knows how to talk to me. So why does he need to tell you to come tell me what the Lord has not said? So the Lord had to prove a point too. And I got to hurry up. He had to prove a point to, if I'd stayed with my paper, I'd be through now. He had to prove a point to Satan. He had to prove a point to Job's friend. And sometimes when you're going through things and people are looking down on, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it, because you know that you've not sinned to bring that upon yourself. And let me tell you something. When you know what you know, Don't you worry about what nobody else, amen, is saying about you. Let me tell you something. Bad things happen to good folk. Amen. Let me say that again. Bad things happen to good people. Amen. And just because things happen in your life, it does not mean you've been sinning. Amen. As a matter of fact, a lot of times they happen because we are doing right. But let me tell you the last thing that God had to prove. God had to prove to Job that his faith was genuine. If you go back and you read Job chapter 1, the Lord spoke concerning Job that he was a man that eschewed evil. He was upright in all of his ways. He was perfect. Amen. Not perfect in the sense of being perfect, but he was perfect in the fact that he followed God and he followed the will of God. Amen. And God spoke that concerning Job because it said there was a man in the land of Uz. This is God talking, describing Job. Now, can God say that about us? But yet, God allowed this to happen to Job because that was something Job needed to know. And let me tell you what Job needed to know. Even though he was close to God, Job still needed to get just a little bit closer. Sometimes we can become so holy that we become comfortable where we are. And God has to allow some things to happen to kind of shake us out of that rut that we've gotten ourselves in. You know, I'm not going to look at nobody. Coming to church on Sunday, sitting in the same seat, clapping at the same time every Sunday. It's become ritualistic with us. And don't let nobody get in our... Sometimes God has to shake us out of our comfort zone. And that's what he did with Job. He shook him out of his comfort zone. If you go on over and you read chapters 38, 39, and 40, Job was asking the question. He said, if I could just see God, I'd plead my case. How many of you have ever told God, I don't understand why I'm going through this? You know what? I know y'all holy. Y'all ain't never done that. You've been holy all your life. And every time something happens in your life, you just sit there and you just say, thank you, God. Hallelujah. Bless his holy name. But I'm real. Because sometimes when things began to happen, I asked the Lord, why? Let me tell you something, and I'm going to hurt somebody's theology. Do you not know God don't mind you asking why? Do you know the reason why? Because he's got an answer. But let me tell you what God cannot stand. Let me get back up here because I'll be a while. Let me tell you what God cannot stand. He cannot stand us complaining while we are going through what we are going through. But God does not mind us asking why. Do you remember when Jesus met the blind man that was born blind? And the disciples asked the question, who's sinned? They were really saying, why is this man like this? Who's sinned, him or his parent? And Jesus said, neither. But for the glory of God, when you are going through what you are going through, if all God says to you is, it's for my glory, then you ought to thank God that he's counted you worthy. that he will show his glory upon your life. Let me say this and I'll quit. James says, my brother, count it all joy. There are two meanings to that. The first meaning is that while you are in the midst of your trials and tribulations, while you are going through what you're going through, we ought to count it all joy. That's one meaning of it. But let me tell you what the second meaning of it is. The second meaning of it is once you are out of what you've gone through and you turn around and you look where God has brought you from, you can count what you've gone through as joy. And let me tell you what that will do for you. The next time that you find yourself in some trial or tribulation, you can count it joy because of what you know. You know that God is not taking you to, but he's carrying you through. And that one day I'll be able to turn around and look. And I'll be able to say like the songwriter, how I got over. Can I get a witness? Okay. Whatever it is, anybody going through anything right now? Anybody going through something? Whatever it is you're going through, count it all joy. I ask this question again. How many is going through? Then count it all joy. Let me tell you the reason why you can count it joy. It's because God is bringing you out. But before you can come out, you got to go. Hey, man. So that you did know, I got 6 pages of notes here. But the Lord said, do it that way. Let me tell you the reason why. Because we need to understand that there's a purpose in everything that we go through in life. No matter how hard, no matter how tough it is, because you belong to God, there is a purpose. And know this, it's only a test. And tests are not given to cause you to fail, but they are given to cause us to pass. How many of you want to be promoted in God's work? Remember, you raise your hand. That means that you don't mind taking a test. Remember, it's only a test. I don't know who that's for today, but remember, it's only a test. And it's only to make your faith stronger. Not weaker, but stronger. The doors of the church are open over 2,000 years ago. Jesus opened the doors out on a hill called Calvary. As he hung there on that old rugged cross, shed his innocent blood so that you and I might have a right to the tree of life. Today we just stand to extend that invitation that he opened over 2,000 years ago. He died He was buried. Stayed in the grave for 3 days. But on that third day, he rose. And he rose with all power, both in heaven and earth, in his hand. But let me tell you something else that happened. 50 days later, he sent the Holy Spirit to indwell each and every one of us. How many of you have been filled with the Spirit? And with the Holy Spirit on the inside of us, guess what? We can make it. Whatever we're going through, we can make it. Because we have the power on the inside of us to be able not only to make it, but to take it. Because God will not leave us alone. You might feel like you're walking the journey by yourself, but know this, he's right there. Because he said in his word, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. And let me tell you something, I believe his word. I trust his word. Whatever he said, he will do that. The doors of the church are open. We extend an invitation to salvation. Candidate for baptism. Church membership. Will you come? Our deacons and our ministers, we stand to receive you. Will that be one? Thank you for joining us by live streaming for our worship service today. We are now in the process of extending an invitation in our sanctuary, but I want to also extend an invitation to you, our viewers, if you don't know Jesus Christ in the pardon of your sins, that you might get to know him today. The Bible tells us in Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10, that if thou wilt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God has raised him. So if you are a non-believer and you would like to confess Jesus Christ, if you want to become a Christian today, all you have to do is confess with your mouth and believe in your heart. And it's just that simple. You are saved. Also, if you're interested in having us to pray for you, you can visit our website. There's a place there for you to submit a prayer request. Or if you're interested in becoming a member of the Friendship Baptist Church in the colony, you can also visit our website, and there is a place there for you to make that request also. But most of all, thank you for joining us today via live streaming as we worship our God in spirit and in truth. May God bless you and keep you, and may you have a blessed week. Amen. We thank God for what he has done here today.